and here they are ordering intelligence and spying on U.S. citizens. Right? This is totally inconsistent with their charter.
Well, what the president has said, and he said it in recent days, is that, look, if you don't have anything to worry about, we're not recording your calls, we're not reading your emails, that's not happening, unless you're basically talking to someone that we suspect is involved in terrorist activity, you don't have anything to worry about. He said that on Friday, he said that over the weekend, he said that in Germany, I'm paraphrasing what he said, but he said that with a global, and of course we have to strike a balance here, but the regular citizens of the United States, you don't have to worry.
He was referring to the conversation he had with his wife just before the bombing. So that was internally in the U.S.
Yeah, but he's not an American citizen. He wasn't an American citizen either. He was a permanent resident.
That's true. But the other point was that Director Mueller of the FBI testified on the 30th of March of 2011 to the Senate Judiciary Committee where he was responding to the question of how would he prevent a teacher Fordhood tutor that was someone in the U.S. becoming radicalized and shooting someone in the U.S. and killing people in the U.S. So he said, we got together with the Department of Defense and created this technology database that allowed us to go back into this space with one query and pull out all tasks and all future emails on a person. So that says they have all this information stored in the FBI lab. That's also what the warrant said.
So when we hear about this big facility that the plans were underway for in Utah, 4 football fields long, I'm sure you are aware of this being one of the great intelligence centers in the United States and kind of the middle of nowhere, what would be there? I mean, I guess it's on hold for now, the construction of this or the completion of this, but what would be going on there?
Well, it's storage of content, of information. By my calculations, if you took it at 20 terabytes a minute of input of the world's communication, including all U.S., there's enough space there to hold up to 500 years of the communications of the world.
Wow.
So that's content storage. You need lots of storage if you're going to store content for searching and manipulating.
So is it part of the concern here that once content is stored, I think they were claiming a few days ago that it was only for 5 years. Do you buy that, by the way?
No, I don't. I mean, I don't buy that at all.
Okay, so they're claiming that the stuff is kept for 5 years, and you're saying you don't believe that. So let's say in the future you are accused of something, some wrongdoing or unethical conduct, you or anyone. So the concern is that they then can go back in time and use stuff that they had no right to take in the first place and then use it against you in a prosecution, maybe some unlawful government harassment, for goodness sakes, who knows? But that's the backward way of doing things in our criminal justice system. You're
that's
supposed to be innocent until proven guilty.
And I believe that that's one of the reasons that Thomas Tam, the DOJ lawyer, was one of the sources for the New York Times article exposing this program initially back in 2005.
Why do you think the Republicans are so eager to circle the wagon on this on Capitol Hill? A lot of neoconservative types, of course.
Because a lot of them have been complicit in this program from the very beginning. And the same is true with the Democrats. They're a part of it.
So they've been briefed, they've been up to date on this, and they never raised any objections, so
no,
it looks bad for them now to say, well, this is terrible.
Yeah, well, for example, that's why I maintain that Nancy Pelosi, when she was Speaker, said that impeachment of George Bush is off the table because she was the ranking member of the House Intelligence Committee when this program came in, and she was one of the first four who were briefed on it, and she approved it.
Well, I think that's very unfair of you, William.
Okay, I'm sorry.
Imagine if Nancy Pelosi were here responding to this.
I was just trying to connect the dots.
No, exactly. Well, connecting the dots is what we want intelligence to actually do in this country. So the argument, and you, I'm sure you saw General Alexander's testimony a few days ago, was that, look, we were able to stop basically 50 terrorist attacks. These programs have protected the United States, and they're critical. 20 countries are across the world were involved, and at least 10 of these events included homeland-based threats. What was your reaction to that?
Well, I knew what he was doing. He was mixing a number of programs together to justify them all collectively. In other
Sounds
words,
better, bigger number, in other words.
Yeah, that's right. But the point was, no program that they said they stopped or attempted attack that they stopped that I know of that he had mentioned didn't. All of them included some foreign connection to a terrorist-related person or activity. So then, and I like these rules then when I left NSA, I said there's really only two things you have to do. One is what I call the 2-degree separation zone of suspicion, which is if you have a terrorist possibly in the United States, then you look at who that person, that's the first degree. And the second degree would be who that person in the United States calls. That's the second degree. That's your zone of suspicion. So then you have to examine those people, and then also those that the other points, which you look at those who envision jihadi advocating sites, or those who advocate violence against West. That then, if you have those people in your zone of suspicion, then that is your zone. And I don't know any terrorist that didn't fit in that zone. And the rest of the 300 million U.S. citizens, you don't even have to copy or look at. And the same is true with the other 7 billion people in the world. And yet they opted to take in everything because they couldn't figure that out. And I even left them with the principle of how you can use the grant to do that.
I want to play for you, if you don't mind, a soundbite from Sean Joyce, who's the FBI Deputy Director, who also spoke out on the efficacy of these NSA monitoring and surveillance programs. And so they tried to outline some of the planned attacks that they had thwarted.
NSA utilizing 702 authority was monitoring a known extremist in Yemen. This individual was in contact with an individual in the United States named Khalid Ouzani. Ouzani and other individuals that we identified through a Pfizer that the FBI applied fraud through the FIS were able to detect a nascent plotting to bomb the New York Stock Exchange.
So when people hear that, it's pretty powerful, right? They say, well, you guys want to handcuff the NSA and the FBI without this information. We could have Times Square blowing up, New York Stock Exchange blowing up, sir.
But I would say right off the bat, that's all legitimate, and it's all